All right. Good morning, everyone. I'm Ashutosh. I'm a SRE at eBay. That's one of the things that I do in between doing other things. Part of those other things is what I want to talk about today, Madaari ordering for the monkeys. Before I start, just a quick show of hands. Who here does production operations slash SRE slash DevOps at work? Okay. Keep your hand up if you have heard of or are practicing chaos engineering or fault injection. Okay. Thank you. Has any of one of you read this paper? One person. Great. So then this talk is perfectly suited for this audience. We'll go a little bit beyond what this paper talked about. Okay, so let's start. And so what are we going to talk about today? We're going to talk about distributed systems, especially why they are difficult to test. We're going to look at one of the techniques that industry has adopted, i.e. chaos engineering. We're going to look at what pitfalls and drawbacks that technique has. Then we're going to deep dive into LDFI or lineage driven fault injection, which allows us to overcome some, if not all, of the limitations of those techniques. And then we will look at how we want to sort of order or prioritize our fault injection experiments and what benefits will we get if we do the prioritization. And then I want to talk about how you can bring LDFI to your organization within the enterprise with the tool set that you have right now. And then I'll share results of when we did this at eBay, what kind of bugs we saw and how we did all of this work. This talk is going to get a little bit dense in the first half. It's going to be a little bit technical and very dense, but hold on. I will ensure that by the time we reach the end, you have sort of a practitioner's sense of how you can actually implement all of this without really a lot of fuss. Okay, so let's start. This was joint work between a UCSC, which is University of California, Santa Cruz. That's where I went to grad school for. Peter Alvaro is the assistant professor there. He teaches distributed systems there. And LDFI was his original PhD thesis that we have then, over the last few years, taken on and molded into newer things. This was joint work between Peter, Kamla, and the eBay SRE team. I'm part of the team now. Okay, so if you're curious as to why the title comes from a Hindi word called Madaari, and Madaari means an orchestrator for the monkeys, or someone who teaches the monkey new tricks. And if you're wondering where the monkey comes from, the monkey is, of course, we can attribute it to Netflix with their creation of Chaos Monkey. Okay, so we have all seen this microservices Death Star architecture. And hopefully you're not in one of these situations, but I happen to be in one of those. These modern web-scale applications are often developed and deployed using software components that are thought to be fault-tolerant. These microservices offer us the benefits of fine-grained units of deployment, agility, and most importantly, they have allowed us to scale our organizations. So when these seemingly fault-tolerant software components are put together or pulled together to create a system, our system as a whole is not fault-tolerant. Why is that the case? That is because fault tolerance as a property is not composable. You cannot put two fault-tolerant components together and expect the entire system as a whole to have same or similar properties. Nonetheless, we expect our systems as a whole to be fault tolerant. So what do we want to do about it? We want to test like the hell out of these systems. But why is testing the hell out of these systems incredibly difficult? Consider this. if you have a system with 100 microservices, and 100 these days is not a large number, and you wanted to explore one fault scenario at a time, with i.e. fault cardinality is one, you have to explore possibly 100 faults. As soon as you venture into multi-fault cardinality space, let's say four, you may have to perform up to 3 million experiments to see if the system tolerates these faults or not. Now, as developers, our challenge is to make individual software components as fault tolerant as possible. And as SREs, our job is to ensure that the end-to-end fault tolerance properties of the system are there. This has motivated the need for new techniques within the industry, and we'll talk about one of them. So over the last few decades, we as an industry have adopted several techniques like unit testing, integration testing, model checkers, to various degrees of success. All of these techniques, while necessary, have proven to be insufficient when it comes to distributed systems. They are not able to test exactly those parts of code that give the system its fault tolerance. Now, keeping that in mind, industry came up with this idea of, okay, we will go ahead and do chaos engineering. So what is chaos engineering? Chaos engineering is this idea of proactively perturbing the system, proactively injecting chaos or some disturbance within the system, and try and understand how the system is going to behave. Part of this chaos may include node reboots, network partitions, certificate expiries, GC pauses. And when the system is subjected to these faults, the system often reveals its tricks with respect to fault tolerance. It's either going to tolerate the fault or not. If it does, you will know how the system tolerated the fault that it did. Okay, so before we go any further, let's go one step deeper into chaos engineering and understand what is the current state of the art. So there are basically two broad forms of chaos engineering that are going on in the industry right now. In the first model, in the first sort of mechanism, there is no model of the system. We treat the system like a black box. And then we roll the dice and inject a fault at random. An example of such a system is Chaos Monkey. Chaos Monkey has proven itself to be extremely useful and successful. And that is evidenced by the popularity of the tool. The other approach is to have a genius. A genius that holds the mental model of the system by observing these executions in production. The genius often augments that mental model by talking to the developers who are working on the product. Now, through that mental model, the genius is able to guide the fault injection infrastructure in a way that exposes the weakness of the system. Now, both of these techniques have been fairly successful, but both of them are inherently not scalable. Why is that the case? In the first mechanism, we are not able to quantify the progress that we have made. We cannot say if we have explored all of the faults. Have we explored at least the critical ones? Am I okay to ship the service now? There is no way to quantify that progress. And in the second mechanism, human in the loop process is inherently not scalable. How many SREs or how many geniuses will you hire in the org to keep a mental model of the system? And sort of that system is evolving. It's becoming bigger and bigger every day. So these two techniques, while successful, have some inherent limitations which we need to overcome. This is where LDFI or Lineage Driven Fault Injection is going to come into picture. I'm going to show over the course of next half an hour or so how LDFI overcomes some, if not all, of the limitations of the existing techniques. Okay. So before we go anywhere near fault LDFI, let's talk about fault tolerance from an abstract standpoint. I'm going to make the claim that fault tolerance necessarily equals redundancy. Why do I make that claim? I'm able to make that claim because every execution or request that was successful in production in spite of a fault being there was successful because that execution was able to find an alternate path somewhere through the system and finish successfully. Now, LDFI is going to use this trick, as you will see in a little while, to sort of suggest chaos engineering experiments. And more abstractly, let's think about this. What's the most difficult question we ask ourselves every day? We usually tend to look at our systems using our observability infrastructure and try and ask, why did this thing fail? Why did things go wrong? As with most things in life, what if we did not try and answer the toughest question? What if we posed a rather different question to ourselves? So let's not ask why did things go wrong? Let's ask why things went right. So what is the benefit of asking this seemingly strange question of why did things go right? The benefit is that you first get to understand the lineage or the explanation of why things are successful in production. Keep in mind that almost everything in production succeeds. And success is often a bigger data set than failure. So there's that going for that line of argument. So traditionally, we have used our observability infrastructure, whether it's monitoring, distributed tracing, alerting, et cetera, to sort of understand failure in production. Now with LDFI, what we want to do is ask a different question. Why did things go right? And LDFI is going to use this question and the answer to this question to sort of suggest fault injection experiments. Now let's take a look at how LDFI is going to be able to do all of this by sort of asking a different question than the norm. Let's start out with the simplest possible distributed system, okay? And ask, why did the good thing happen? And then we'll come to how we can make the bad thing happen. So what do we want to do? So we have a client, and the client is going to send broadcast message to two replicas. And if the message reaches both replicas, then we have a write that is stable or durable. That's the goal. We want to have stable writes. Now, what could possibly go wrong? Anything could go wrong. The broadcast could fail. The replicas could crash. So what is a fault then? Basically, what we are looking to do is find cuts in the graph that you see on the right that is going to break all possible supports for this execution to succeed. How do we visualize and develop intuition for that? So let's take this example again. What if we break the broadcast one and storage on replica A? Okay? We can break that. That's one way of thinking about it. Then there is an alternate path that we need to look at. Is that it? Are there only two paths? No, there are two more. There's one where replica A and broadcast 2 are involved, and in the other path, replica B and broadcast 1 is involved. So if we have to break all of the supports, then we have to break all of the four edges together. So how will we sort of encode this problem for our machinery to sort of solve and look at? Our hypothesis, and you'll sort of start to observe that there's a Boolean formula on the left, and this is known as a conjunctive normal form formula, which is ands over ors. So if you sort of look at it, then if I fail broadcast 1 and broadcast 2, that's my hypothesis, then I'm going to probably break all possible supports. This is what LDFI is going to use to be able to sort of suggest faults. Hopefully now you have some intuition of why looking at lineage can allow you to sort of infer or decide where should you target your fault injection infrastructure. Okay. So what is LDFI doing overall? LDFI is looking at lineage of successful executions to build a model of systems redundancy. It's trying to understand why the system tolerated a fault that it did in production. Okay. So with these, with some intuition, now we need a recipe for building this entire machinery. So let's start out with a successful outcome. By a successful outcome, we mean a end-to-end test that is going to exercise your system. This could be you hitting an API. This could be you trying to write to a database. This could be you sort of driving the UI through Selenium, anything. So what do we want to do? We want to look at the outcome of that end-to-end interaction and then work backwards. We want to understand the lineage of that execution or the explanation of why that execution succeeded. Then we want to take that explanation and encode it into conjunctive normal form. Once we have done that, we can feed this to an off-the-shelf SAT solver. SAT is basically satisfiability problem. It's a computer science-y thing, but if you want to, you can gloss over the details. Not particularly interesting right now. Then the solution that comes out of a SAT solver is basically the next fault or set of faults to be injected. Now, when you inject the fault into the system based on what the SAT solver tells you, there are two possibilities. In the first case, the system is going to fail, in which case, hooray, we have found a bug, so let's go ahead and fix that bug and we'll come back. In the alternate scenario, the system is going to succeed. The execution is going to succeed. In which case, LDFI has learned how the system is tolerating the fault that you just injected. With this new knowledge, LDFI can augment or sort of update its model with the explanation of why the fault was tolerated. Now, you know, you can sort of start to imagine that if you run this entire thing in a loop over and over again, you will either run out of faults to suggest, or you can sort of say that my system tolerates whatever kind of fault that you wanted to inject. Okay. So now we'll zoom in into all of these boxes one at a time to understand how this machinery works under the hood. Okay. So let's go into familiar territory of microservices and look at the simplest possible call graph. This call graph is rooted at A and has five services. So what would it take for this entire execution to fail? Either A can fail, or B, or C, or D, or E. So let's say we decide to fail B. So the node in red represents possibly a failed RPC call. Now, what would it take for the execution on the right to fail? A can fail, or C, or D, or E. Now, LDFI has witnessed these two executions, and it will try and sort of create a model of how the system tolerated the fault in B. To do that, it will quite simply do an AND over these two ORs, do these two big formula containing ORs. This is basically the system's redundancy encoded in conjunctive normal form. All right. So what we have seen so far is the initial incarnation of LDFI, what it used to do a while back. I haven't come to any bits about ordering yet. But we need to understand the drawbacks of whatever I have shown you so far. Now, SAT being a decision problem inherently does not allow you to order faults or order sort of literals. That goes against our intuition as developers and SREs. Why is that the case? Because we know that certain services are more likely to fail in production than other services. Here's some intuition for you. A service that was released yesterday is more likely to have bugs or fail in production than a service that has not been released for 3 months. we want to be able to sort of encode that intuition into running experiments. We want to prioritize experiments in a way where our intuition is sort of there in LDFI. There are a couple of other things we want to do. We want to find the faults before the users do, and we want to conduct as few an experiments as possible. We want to conduct basically, if you invert it, more number of experiments per unit time. And we'll see an example later on why that can be quite useful as well. Okay. So this intuition that I just described, we're going to look at the same call graph again and try and understand how we can potentially attach our intuition of ordering or prioritization to faults. Before we go anywhere near the theoretical aspects of that exercise, let's try to do the simplest possible thing. I want to use the structure of the call graph to give me ordering of faults. The simplest possible mechanism that I can think of is the rank of the node, the distance from the root to the node under consideration. And let's take this call graph and see what we can achieve. I took this call graph and I decided to fail C. Why would I want to do that? What benefits can I potentially get? If I am lucky, post-injection of failure in C, and if the system succeeds nonetheless, then I do not have to inject any faults in D, E, and F, which means three fewer experiments. Why is that the case? Think about it this way. Failure in F is going to manifest as failure in E. Failure in E is going to manifest as failure in C. Failure in D is also going to manifest as failure in C. So if the system tolerated the absence or the faults in C, we don't need to care about D, E, and F. We don't have to inject faults there. So we have suddenly reduced our search space by half. Okay, so what did we do? We use the simplest possible criteria for ordering of faults. We use the rank of the service of the node. If you want to break ties, you can use the size of the subgraph that is below the service as well. And as I said, if you survive the failure of C, you don't need to worry about D, E, and F. Okay, so we looked at LDFI in its original form when it used to use SAT solvers. Then we looked at how adding ordering is important. Our intuition tells us that's going to give us good benefits. And now let's look at how we can make that transition from conjunctive normal form and SAT solvers to the other mechanism of prioritization of faults. So we wanted to order faults and consider, let's say, these four or five executions. And that's the CNF formula you get. Now, you can also look at the CNF formula as basically sets. These are tuples, or these are sets, where these services are members. Now, what do I want to do? I want to play basically darts. I want to throw darts at these sets. What are the rules of throwing darts? In this case, I want to throw darts such that I hit all of the sets and at least one service in each set. Okay? Now this allows me to translate the problem from SAT to what is known as a minimal hitting set problem. Now an example of one solution, possible solution, is C, E, and H. Notice that we have covered all of the sets, and there is at least one service in each of these sets. Okay? So that's one transition that we have made. We no longer have a Boolean formula. We have these sets of things that we can possibly work with. We currently don't have ordering yet. We will achieve that in the next step. So what can we do? So we looked at quite possibly a similar execution and said, okay, we want to change sort of the entire story from a decision problem, which is what do I do next, which is what SAT allowed us to do, which fault should I inject next, to what, where do we want to go? We want to go to which is the best fault to be injected. Okay, and best is an arbitrary criteria that you will get to decide what best actually means. Now, this optimization problem, forget about the math. There is proof for how all of this machinery works, but you can skip it for now. The optimization problem as a whole is subject to the same constraints as the decision problem, i.e. that we need to pick one service from each set, and we need to make sure that all sets are hit. Now, in this example, there must be a solution for the service such that there is one service in ABC, CDEF, and a DEF. And the solutions will be sort of ordered by the priorities we attach to these services. What can be the priority of these services? One priority that we looked at was the rank of the node. Another priority could be the bug rate in service. Another priority could be time since last release. You could also add priorities for, let's say, production incident history or alerts which have, or services with most number of alerts as warnings and so on and so forth. So you have this, these multiple metrics that you can attach to a single service to decide, okay, what that potentially, that probability that you see attached to each service can be. We'll see some examples of these priorities as well. Therefore, the solution to this optimization function is a tuple of services that we can then go ahead and sort of inject fault in. And these tuples are basically ordered by their priorities. Okay, so when you have chosen to sort of put the entire mechanism in this formulation, instead of using an off-the-shelf SAT solver before, now you can use an off-the-shelf ILP solver to do all of this. I know this seems all a little bit tangly and intimidating, but when it actually comes down to writing code, this is actually fairly simple to do. Okay, so why do we want to inject faults that matter? Let's do a recap. We know that all services are not created equal. Some services are more likely to fail than others. There's also this containment hierarchy model, that probability of a node failure is significantly higher than probability of a rack failure, which is significantly higher than probability of a data center failure. We also know about these historical measures, and hopefully you're tracking your incident histories where the time since last release, history of bugs, bug rates, history of failures rather, they are all contributing factors to how we should order the experiments. And as we looked at earlier, if we sort of pick and choose the right order of experiments, we will have to potentially do fewer experiments. Okay. So now that we have gone deep into the LDFI theoretical territory, let's come back to the real world and see how all of this can be implemented using simple mechanisms in your organization. Okay, so to build LDFI or sort of build that pipeline in your organization, you essentially need three building blocks. The first one is explanations of why executions are successful. The second one is a way to build models of systems redundancy. And the third one is a mechanism to inject faults in your system. Now, with all of these three building blocks put together, you can run the entire pipeline in a loop on the system that you are sort of considering. So let's go into all of these blocks one by one and see how we achieved all of this at eBay, and potentially you can do something similar in your org as well. The first thing is about explanations. What are explanations anyway? In modern sort of microservices system, you can equate them to sort be distributed traces. Distributed traces are nothing but ordered events with context stitched together. So what distributed tracing allows us to do is basically look at a request as it navigates its way through the system one service at a time. We can create a call graph using these traces, and these call graphs can then subsequently be encoded into whatever mechanism you choose, CNF, ILP, whatever makes you happy. Now, there may be a situation where you do not have distributed tracing in your organization. Then what is the solution? In fact, at eBay, we did not have distributed tracing when we started this project. We only had structured logs with sufficient metadata like timestamp and correlation ID. This allowed us to sort of use the technique of log stitching and convert these structured logs into open tracing compatible traces and then sort of create call graphs from there. That's another mechanism that you can use. Okay. So now to the part of having a fault injection tool. We had our own set of constraints at eBay, so we decided to create our own fault injection tool. And of course, if you create your own tool, you get to use very cute names like Mowgli. Mowgli is a eBay topology-aware fault injection tool. It's sort of it's aware of circuit breakers and so on and so forth, availability zone aware and all of that. It does have capabilities for auditing, tracking, and is meant to be safe by default. If there is one tip that I can give you about creating your own fault injection tool, it's that you should always have built-in rollback or safety mechanisms for the tool that you build. Even if you're not building your tool and you're grabbing something from open source, make sure that you have the ability to roll back whatever fault you went ahead and injected. Safety first, always. I've left some links on common open source tools as well. Okay. The last thing, one other thing that you need is an end-to-end test. So whatever system you choose, you need to have an end-to-end test and a binary success or failure criteria. So if you have a UI-based application, then possibly a Selenium-based test with some assertions on some elements of the UI to tell you true or false whether this interaction as a whole succeeded or not. If you are in the API world, then an assertion on the status code of the return from the API to sort of understand whether this interaction succeeded or not. With APIs, status codes tend to lie. There are a lot of people who are very happy converting 500s and 400s into 200s. You want to be very careful about that. So if you are in such a situation, then you are better off basically going to stable storage or database to find out the real status of the transaction. This is critical because you would never want to corrupt the model that is stored within LDFI. You never want to be in a situation where something failed and you thought it was successful and you pass that on to LDFI. That's going to give you wrong solutions. There's one more beast that we need to tame, which is eventually consistent workflows. How can we do that? Surprisingly, this is really easy in LDFI. So if you have an eventually consistent system, and you look up the result of that execution at a later date, then you can come back and register the result of that workflow or that transaction into LDFI. As long as you never corrupt the model, i.e. turn failure into success, LDFI will do the right thing automatically. You don't have to block. There's no need for doing things synchronously. You can always come back and register the result of an async computation. Okay. So let's pull everything together and see how we close the loop. So when you run the LDFI pipeline, the first thing that you want to do is run an end-to-end test in steady state. In the steady state, the execution has to succeed because at this time, we have not injected any fault into the system. Then we look at the traces or structured logs and convert them into call graphs. These call graphs are then further converted into the model of systems redundancy through CNF formulation or ILP formulation. And once we do that, the solver will go ahead and take that formula and solve it. The solution that comes out of the solver is what you will feed into the fault injection tool of your choice. Now, once you have injected the fault, you can look at the result and then proceed with the next set of experiments. Looking at the result means if the thing failed, you have a bug. If the thing succeeded, LDFI has learned something new about the system. All right. For reference, I'm showing some libraries that we used to build all of this machinery as well. OK. So with all of the theoretical and implementation details figured out, we move on to running the experiments. This is a real call graph from eBay's payments platform. So when you do checkout on eBay, this is possibly the set of services that you will run into. So the nodes marked in green are basically services that we know a priori are going to cause a hard failure. So we put them in sort of a white list so that LDFI doesn't suggest them as failure points of injection. As LDFI starts to suggest experiments, it suggests service 2 for failure. Service 2 is on the extreme right. So what we noticed was that the system as a whole tolerated the fault. This allowed us to sort of prune away services 6 and 7. We did not have to inject any fault in service 6 and 7. Now, as LDFI suggested more experiments, we reached service 11, bang in the center. Again, the system was able to tolerate that fault. And we did not have to inject any faults in service 22, 23, and 38. But notice how we did not ignore service 29, bottom left middle. Why is that the case? We were not able to ignore service 29 because there is an alternate path from the root, 1 through 5 through 10 through 21. LDFI has not witnessed any execution so far where the system has tolerated the absence or failure in 29. So we have to keep that around. Service 27 is similar to 29. Okay. So overall, we found 6 bugs, some old, some new. The bugs ranged from total functionality failure to wrong status code reporting to bad user experience on the site. Okay, and we overall finished the entire exercise in a few hours. To sort of have a comparison, we wrote a uniform and random fault injector, something similar to what Chaos Monkey does. And it should not come as a surprise that LDFI, especially when it decides to, when we decided to go for ordered fault injection, is significantly more efficient than Chaos Monkey. In fact, it's orders of magnitude more efficient. We were able to finish the entire exercise in one fault strategy mode with only 17 experiments. In our case, having Mowgli also gave us benefits because Mowgli does not suffer from having to wait for node reboots in a cloud environment to finish before proceeding to next experiment. Okay, so that was one result. And now I want to move on to another more interesting result where we found no bugs. And you would want to understand why finding no bugs is still an interesting result for us. Again, the premise is the same. Nodes marked in green are basically services that are known to cause hard failure, and so we put them in a whitelist. As soon as we reached service 6 and we were able to tolerate the failure in service 6, we pruned away the entire subgraph below 6. So 6 services went away. And overall, we conducted roughly half of the number of experiments that would otherwise be the overall cardinality of the graph. Why is this result interesting? Because this result shows that we can finish the suite of experiments in a reasonable time. Why is that important? It's important because eventually we want all of this machinery to be inside our CI pipeline. And if this is to be part of our CI pipeline, then all the experiments need to finish in a reasonable amount of time. OK. With all of these results, hopefully we have motivated why ordering of faults matters. Hopefully I have also motivated why LDFI is a technique and not a tool. You will have to bring your own tools to the party. So whatever kind of infrastructure that you are running, you get to decide what maturity level you are at and what kind of mechanisms you want to use to build the entire LDFI pipeline. OK. So what does the future hold for LDFI and Madaari as a whole? I talked about how each service can be associated with multiple metrics or probabilities. We want to see if we can automate away that entire process, basically arrive at a single theta for each service, which is going to be unique to your architecture. LDFI as a whole remains oblivious to whatever architecture, microservices, macroservices, whatever it is that we are running these days, and it sort of understands what that theta will be. In this world of microservices, as we are starting to attach SLAs to our services, we think we can use LDFI again for SLA verification as well by using strategic delay injection. We also want to reason about stateful systems. We have a lot of services where state trades hand from one service to another. We think there are rich opportunities to not only improve the resilience of the system, but also find bugs. And overall, sort of, I want to finish this slide with this one, again, reiterate the same thing, that LDFI is a technique, not a tool. So it can, and it has been applied to databases, containers, service mesh, so on and so forth. OK, so now that we are at a conference, and we wouldn't want to leave a conference without some opinions. So what do I think is the future of chaos engineering? Here's what me and all of my colleagues think. We think chaos engineering should have three W's. What to inject, i.e. which fault do you want to inject, network partition, reboots, GC pauses, so on and so forth. Where should you inject the fault? Which software component or hardware component do you want to target? LDFI can help answer that question. We also want to arrive at when should we inject a fault. Here's some intuition for that. I want to inject a fault when there are exactly 7 items in my cart. How do I do that? Currently, there is no known way of being able to do that. No tool, no technique exists to be able to answer that question. So how can we answer that question? Here's one idea. So in distributed systems, time is the hardest beast to track. Again, as I mentioned earlier, what if we don't try and solve the hardest problem? Let's think about it this way. What's time? Time is this implicit ordering that you get in a distributed system when events occur or change of state happens. So what do we want to do? We want to make this journey from the domain of time to the domain of state and then back. Think event source systems. Now, if you are able to move between time and state, then you are able to do the following. You are able to come up with a predicate that a service can evaluate over its local state. So as soon as a service sees, aha, do I have 7 items in my cart? The predicate is true. Yep, now's the time to inject a fault. We think this is possible to do. There are emerging technologies that will allow us to do that. But that's an interesting avenue that we are looking at. OK, so what did we learn today? We learned how industry and academia can work together on seemingly difficult yet interesting things. We learned about the limitations of LDFI with respect to unordered solutions and how we sort of made the journey into ordered solutions. Hopefully, we also motivated why ordering of faults matters and why and how sort of the results show that basically gave us the biggest bang for our buck. Hopefully, I have also given you enough of an incentive to sort of take LDFI back to your enterprise and try and build that pipeline as a whole. And overall, as you in your organization, if you want to do new things, start small, stay simple. That was our philosophy, and that is what allowed us to sort of achieve all of this with some degree of success. With that, I'm going to stop, and I'm ready to take questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the talk. Any questions? So we had a few questions.
Okay.
How does gathering lineage differ from building a mental model of the system, like the genius in the first couple of the slide?
Okay. So the biggest difference is the factor of scalability. Humans inherently don't scale. While I earlier showed the example of 100 services, so a genius can probably accommodate 100 services. But as soon as you reach 200, 300, and then K such systems, the genius can no longer hold that in his or her head. And I have live examples as colleagues on my team who for multiple years held the entire stack in their head, but as we evolved, their knowledge of the system has decreased. So at some point, we had to automate this entire thing away. LDFI is an answer to that problem. For reference, also look for a talk by Peter called Abstracting the Geniuses Away, where he motivates why this notion of having a genius do all of this work for us is not scalable, and sort of why we need this technique in the wild.
Okay. It's possible to apply this technique to a system with a high state. For example, where a system A needs to have complete a job and populate the entries in a database before request on the service B can perform the job.
I would have to read the question.
Yeah, okay. This is possible to apply these techniques to a system with a high state, where you have to different,
Yes, absolutely. So the question is it possible for us to apply LDFI on a in a system where a service A needs to perhaps fully write the state somewhere and then service B can start? Hopefully I've understood the question correctly. Yes, it is. And that's something that we are actively working on to be able to do that. Inherently, LDFI has no limitations per se. So what I mean by that is as long as there is a way of expressing that system's lineage somehow, LDFI will find a way of modeling that. What I mean by that is as long as you have the causality relationships, as long as you have the causality relationships mapped out, Lambert clocks or whatever, if you can get to that, you can get to LDFI.
Thanks, you. Final question. What's the definition of failure tolerance? It can be a grateful failure even if we don't return the request result to the user.
Come again, sorry.
Yeah, what's the definition of failure tolerance?
Okay. So what is the definition of fault tolerance? That is to be decided based on the system under consideration. For a lot of systems, partial degradation or partial failures where the user is still able to somehow execute the intention are okay, and you consider that to be a success. So what essentially LDFI needs is just a binary metric at the end of the day based on the system under consideration, whether this interaction succeeded or not. And what is that binary, or how do you arrive at that binary, is completely up to you. For example, in a lot of cases in our systems, partial registration is perfectly fine. Partial checkout of items in some cases may also be fine. So there is no one-size-fits-all definition of what fault tolerance would be, but it depends on your system. But as long as you can map the result of the execution to either true or false in terms of success, LDFI will accept that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We have no more time for questions.